about what you'll be able to see when it comes to cinemas on the 30th of November. So, ladies and gentlemen, it's now time to watch the trailer for Anna and the Apocalypse. The house,
not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse. Was the night before Christmas, and all through the house, not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse. Young Anna was nestled, all snug in her bed, not knowing tomorrow she'd meet the undead. How would she survive what this season would bring? Well, that's simple. She'd stab, she'd slash, and she'd sing.
Shankill. Zombie Miley, Zombie Rihanna, Zombie Beyonce.
Kill them all, they're zombies.
Yeah, play it properly.
Alex, awesome. Now it's our time to find out a bit more about the film, ladies and gentlemen. So please join me in welcoming our panelists from the film. Let's start off with the director, John McPhail. And next up, we have the writer, Alan McDonald. And he's one of the people you heard behind that great songs like the one you just heard in the trailer. Please get up for the composer, Tommy Reilly. And one of the co-producers, and also somebody who worked hard on the post-production. Please give a brilliant round of applause for Charlotte Walsh. And next up, one of the producers, Naysun, Alae-Carew. And last but by no means least, he's also another producer. Please give a round of applause to the brilliant Mr. Nic Crum. So, good afternoon and welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for joining us. So, John, start off and let's talk about your favourite horror films and how, and also your favourite musicals, and how did they kind of influence you in the making of this movie?
Well, I've been a horror buff since as long as I can remember. My mother weaned me on horror. I always remember like being 9 years old and she sticks her head around the door on a Friday night going, Night of the Living Dead starting on Channel 4. So like horror's always been something I absolutely love. And musicals is something that, like, it's not my favourite genre. Now it is, it's something that I had to sort of like throw myself into. I was quite uncultured when it came to musicals because South Park, Bigger, Longer, Uncut, it's my favourite musical. It is amazing. So I did end up getting when I got the job, I started like watching DVDs and like going to see musicals and things, and I just fell in love with some of them. Like, I absolutely adore West Side Story. I'd never seen West Side Story before, and I just love it.
And you're also a John Carpenter fan, aren't you? So how did that kind of influence you, the work you did in this film?
Well, I love Carpenter movies, and I love how he can actually take, you know, different blends of genres and just play with them throughout his whole career. But even like colour, like, you know, his use of colour, and I don't know how many times I would turn to these guys and go, synths, I need synths, I want synths. Synth daft, so I.
And so you mentioned there getting the job. How did you become involved in the movie?
The boys saw my first feature film, which was a romantic comedy coming of age film at Glasgow Film Festival. And I think you guys had been looking at horror directors and musical directors and just hadn't found that right fit. And the film's just, it's a real simple story, and it's just about like these big characters, and it's just full of heart. And I think that the boys were sort of looking for that for Anna.
And so what was it attracted you guys then to pick John and made him the ideal choice in your minds?
I mean, it's kind of what John said. We spent a long time looking for, we looked at a lot of directors who were incredible horror fans, and we're going to be able to make the gore work for genre fans out there, because we knew they were going to be key to making the film work. And yeah, we looked at people who'd done music videos, and we just, it was probably the better part of a year that we were looking for the right director. And then when we saw John's film, I mean, it was made for, I hope John doesn't mind me saying, but it was made for 50 grand. It was a micro-budget film, and it still had, it just had character, it had heart in it. And at that point, Nic and I were like, well, this is what we're looking for. This is the thing that binds together the horror, the comedy, the musical numbers has to be the characters, and it has to be a kind of sincerity that's still in the film, and that's what John brought to it.
And the film has quite an incredible world that you build up around it. You've got that with the music we've seen and the soundtrack, and you've got a novel. How was this intentional, or did this kind of happen as you kind of went through the project?
Yeah, I guess I'll take that one again. yeah, I mean, we grew up with Star Wars and with worlds that were, we grew up with stories that were worlds, not just individual products. And that's what we always wanted to be able to make, was something where you go, okay, cool, this is a film, but actually it's just one part of a story in a wider world. And so ever since we started making films together, we were always coming at it from that perspective. So that does come with a lot of, I hope we can do this. We don't actually know how to do this. How do you get a novelization of your movie done? And fortunately, we worked with a lot of people who are just experts and just brilliant at it. But yeah, it did start off with the idea that this could be something more. And we also make, our company makes video games as well, so we're kind of used to playing in different spaces. And it was always a key thing for us to be able to, yeah, have more fun beyond the film.
And one of the things your film does very well is it doesn't dwell too much on what started everything. It kind of just goes straight at it and lets the audience almost fill in the imagination. How intentional was that? And is that something then that you managed to expand upon in the book?
That was very intentional. Yeah, when we started off, we wanted fundamentally to make a coming-of-age film. So we wanted to make a teen movie that dealt with all the kind of same things that we loved in other teen movies and TV shows. This is the point where I mentioned Buffy the Vampire Slayer and John rolls his eyes. There it is. John, not a big Buffy fan. Feel free to throw fruit at him. We're interested in teen stories, coming-of-age stories, and we wanted to bring in the musical aspect and the horror aspect to support that. And one thing that I think has really, when people saw our movie coming out, it's been really nice for them to say, oh, we thought the zombie genre was done, but this seems a bit fresh. But one thing I think really is done is that scene where everyone stands around and says, oh, there was patient zero in insert this country here, and then they touched another person, and then there was a bite, and then this spread to four different countries. And if you hang in for 5 minutes, we're going to explain how this worked. We weren't interested. It's fundamentally a story of a teenage girl who has a fight with her dad, and wants to get back to her dad to make up with it because she's desperate to get out of her hometown and wants to explain why she feels this way to him, and then the zombie apocalypse happens. So it's about the characters, as John and Naysun said.
And we're going to have a look at another clip very shortly. So let's have a look at a clip, which we have, I believe, and it's called Soldiers of War.
Oh, I just saw that.
Shit.
What's wrong?
Snow's gone.
Fucking hell, Chris. What about the army?
See for yourself.
Can we turn the sound up?
Everyone's dead. People will still be waiting at the school. We just need to get there.
There's no evacuation coming.
Well, so we'll get your car and leave town.
And go where?
Well, I don't know yet, but we'll figure something out.
Oh, I'm sorry. I forgot. You can do anything.
I'm getting my dad, all right?
Yeah, and my gran and Lisa.
Look, I want to find my mom too, but
How are we gonna get past all the zombies?
I've just had the best idea ever.
This is the stupidest idea ever.
We're all going to die.
We should play a game. Take your mind off it. Helps me when I'm car sick.
Because this is exactly the same.
Steph. Marry,
shag, kill.
Zombie Miley, zombie Rihanna, zombie Beyonce.
Kill them all, they're zombies.
And play it properly.
Marry Beyonce.
Why are you killing Rihanna?
That's not what I said.
Well, obviously you're shagging. Is it a horde? How many's a horde?
Just check!
Shit.
I swear to God, if he says it's snowing again.
Better kill old people. Sitting on your face.
Oh.
Is she pissing?
Oh, fine. It's plastic.
It's warm plastic.
Should have brought some muscle. Hi, John.
Hi, Nick.
Thought your big army dad would have pulled you a favor and shipped you out.
Don't talk about my fucking dad!
Show some fucking respect.
Says the guy who just murdered a whole bunch of grandparents. Actually, you get that on camera. It's a little bit of human interest.
You've been looting. Lovely.
Where is your dad?
Went to the base.
Sorry.
Whatever.
Shit! Get back under! Hiding's for pussies, John boy.
Come on, lads. Can't let the ladies go off without some real men.
If you see any, let me know.
Guess only the bitches survived. Right, Nick?
Shut the fuck up, Graham.
Hey, so where are we going? Somewhere fun?
Thanks.
So how much of a challenge was it to kind of construct songs and set pieces like that that kind of fit into an apocalyptic environment?
It's a very good question. Alan helped a lot by writing like some very fun people to write songs for. But also this is just a dream gig because, like John said, sometimes it's sort of John Hughes-y, twinkly, John Williams-esque Christmas music, and then there's like John Carpenter synth sequences where people are being eaten, and then you get to write like a rock power ballad. So I think because the film's so heightened anyway, you could write a power ballad for a character. So it's been an absolute blast, but just trying to have as much fun as possible.
And some of the songs that are on the soundtrack, which you can get online and you can listen to on Spotify and other places like that, you also got to challenge the conventions of the traditional Christmas song in it. That must have been an absolute, after years of listening to Christmas songs, that must have been an absolute blast.
Oh man, that song was in the very first draft of the script, but they said it was like a tiny Christmas. Oh, there's maybe like a little dirty Christmas song happens at the school show. And I remember latching onto that pretty hard and thinking, I'm going to spend way too much time on that. That's the kind of thing I find really funny.
Also because Tommy loves
Christmas. I love Christmas, man. It's just so good. So I spent a lot of time on that, on trying to make that a whole moment. And you guys kept saying, don't worry about that one. It's not as important. And I spent way too much time worrying about that, me and Roddy. So the idea of writing a dirty Christmas song is the dream come true. It's a dream come true.
And you kind of hinted at the collaboration there with everybody. I mean, how much collaboration exactly did you have? Was there a lot of back and forth between the director, the writer and himself, or was it just they kind of went to you and said, right, this is our vision, go?
Yeah, I think we very much collaboration. We'd write loads of stuff and then run it past everybody and then talk about it and then try something else. And particularly with making sure there's so much story we wanted to get into the song. So talking to Alan and John a lot about what they wanted from each moment was pretty key for us, but sometimes you just got to force the issue and really spend loads of time on a dirty Christmas song.
And what was it like for all of you guys then when you first got to actually kind of hear the songs back and what you'd written? How did you kind of react to them?
It was amazing. Like, so where the boys were recording was like this little like outhouse just outside our main office. So I used to go in there in the mornings and you'd sit down and they would just sit and they'd play away. Like, oh, we've done this last night. Are we finished off this? Are we were doing that? And you would just sit there and you go, ah, that sounds great, boys.
Friday Music Club.
At Friday Music Club, we'd done that, which was like every Friday where we would sort of sit down in a Friday afternoon and we'd just talk about our influences and what kind of stuff we liked. And, you know, like every song had to have a purpose. Every song, it wasn't like, oh, like it's been 15 minutes. We better batter a song in there. You know, we wanted everything to drive the story and drive the characters. So that was something we always talked about, is where we're coming from and where we're going to. So, like, you know, it was something that, as I say, we always sort of discussed and we talked about. But genuinely, it was like an absolute joy to sit and watch these boys. I used to sit in the couch at the back and just drink hunters of coffee and be like fleeing on coffee. Like, ah, it's great, boys. Let's put something else in. Like, bells, put bells in.
And I think we just had a lot of fun, particularly because me and Roddy that wrote the music, we'd never written on a musical before, and John openly admits he didn't really like them. So it was just a lot of people trying something they hadn't done before, and I think that can be a good thing sometimes when the medium ends up winning us all over and we end up totally falling in love with it and having a blast putting it together. Alan, already, you were a diehard musicals guy.
Yeah, I was the one in the room just kind of, I'd been an English and drama teacher for many of the years during which I worked on this film before we all went professional. I say that, you guys were already doing it way ahead of me. And I directed school shows, so like the Dirty Christmas song did not come from experience. I want to put that right on record as that sentence comes out my mouth. But I'd been to lots of school shows and lots of school performances where kind of young people get up and do something just a little bit too inappropriate for the venue. whether that be a dance or some sort of hip-hop number, and that's kind of fed into a lot of stuff in the script. But no, I absolutely adore musicals. My favorite is The Little Mermaid, and I'll fight anyone who disagrees.
It's amazing.
And what kind of challenges then did you face when you were kind of shooting the actual kind of numbers as well on the set? Because it must have been kind of hard to actually choreograph all of this and the fight scenes. And then as well, Charlotte, in the post-production of the film, what kind of challenges did you face trying to bring their vision to life with the dancing and the zombie attacking and everything?
As you may have already got the impression from, these guys are quite excitable when it comes to Christmas and filmmaking and all things, actually. One of my challenges was trying to, you know, keep things moving at the speed I needed to move at within the amount of money that we had, wasn't very much, without also being a huge, you know, buzzkill at the same time. So that was one of them. In terms of music, though, the challenge of both, you know, making sure what worked on set would also work in post-production. One of the things that we didn't really think about too much was that we had originally recorded all the songs before we started shooting, and then after we actually shot and choreographed those pieces, we realized that the energy and the voices didn't necessarily match what we ended up doing in screen. So one of the things we had to do was to then re-record them again afterwards, and get the actors in little rooms by themselves, you know, in little booths, and recreate the energy that they did. And that one of the ones that we did that most with was at the end, which is a big, I won't spoil it, but a big kind of fight scene, song, dance thing. And getting Ella, who plays Anna, the main character in the film, to be able to match all the kind of physical actions she was making while singing at the same time, whilst, you know, matching the musical style was quite difficult. But she did an amazing job, and I think it makes a big difference.
And that must have been one of the challenges of actually casting a particular movie like this, because you've not only got to find talented actors, but you've also got to find talented performers. How long did it kind of take you to assemble that cast?
It took us a good, I think, 8-9 months to actually find everybody, because it was exactly that. And we were kind of keen from the start, and I remember early conversations where we were all adamant we wanted to find actors that could also sing, that everybody was singing their own part. And kind of really, we searched up and down the country. We had kind of numerous auditions and saw hundreds and hundreds of tapes. And it's like, as much as it sounds like the cliche, because it is, but genuinely, when every single person came in, when you first saw Ella, when we first saw Marley, when we first saw Malcolm, like you just knew that that's who we were looking for. That was the character. Particularly, I think for John, for Malcolm, because he's the one that took us the longest to find. And we, you know, we properly kept searching, and then it was right up to prep, and we just kept looking, because we knew that someone would be out there, and he walked in his Ghostbusters jumper, and we like nailed it.
Yeah, Malcolm is John. Yeah. He's the human embodiment of the character. So it was a joy to find that man.
And for all of you then, when you first got to see the film back, what were your initial reactions to it? And kind of, I'm sensing something already from the laughing, but what were your initial reactions? And did it meet the idea and the vision that you first started with?
So, right. Post-production's brilliant fun. So we went into post, and then, like, I think we all, every single one of us, was part of the post-production process. Like, we were all locked in a wee room, and I think we would carry on a lot. Like, it would be a lot of laughing. But at the same time, when you're cutting something like this and you're putting it together, you never know how people are going to take it. You never know. I mean, we think it's funny. We think it's good. But, you know, I mean, that's us. And as I say, we've been sitting in a wee room together for months all laughing. You know, so, like, the actual getting it out there was terrifying. You know, you never know how people are going to take this. And when you tell people, oh, it's a zombie musical set at Christmas, it's the same reaction my mother had when I came home and said, I'm going to direct a zombie musical. Aye, aye. You know, like, is it? It's, people have these perceptions of it, and they think it's going to be just like a mad B movie where we're just like being stupid, you know, and they forget that there's, as I say, they don't know there's this a lot of heart and character to it. And it was making sure that we were hitting all those beats, and making sure that the characters felt real and they felt good and that you could identify with them. So we didn't know, and we never knew until we had our world premiere. And now we went into post in March, and finished in September. I say finished, but so you know, it was such a short time and it's such a short window. But like all our fears went away after that first screening at Fantastic Fest. Fantastic Fest is like one of the world's like biggest genre film festivals in Austin, Texas. And we had two screenings due there over a couple of dates. And I think we walked away with nine, you know, like people, 11, sorry. Like the, like people just like attached themselves to this movie and it was just selling out, selling out, selling out, selling out. And people were coming back. In fact, a guy came up to me and he came and said, I've been to see your film three times. And that's kind of when you know, like, all right, cool. We've got something on our hands here. And the rest was just like, you know, going out to festivals and seeing different audience reactions. And one of the ones I was really scared about was Fright Fest in London, because like that's my audience. I go to Fright Fest, do you know what I mean? I don't want to disappoint people, you know, that audience, because that's me, you know. And when we went down there and, you know, we had our screening and Ella won the Rising Star Award there, and we would end up trending on Twitter. And it was, I think it was at that point, so that was at like 3 months ago, I went, no, we're all right. People are enjoying it.
But I've had that exact reaction. I told a friend of mine I was doing this zombie musical thing. I'm writing some songs for a zombie musical bit, and he's like, that sounds awful. I'm happy for you, man, but I will never watch that. And he walked in it. So it's been a really nice thing getting to show people it and kind of win a few people over and with quite, I know, an interesting idea, you know?
And I think what's worth mentioning right now as well, just from my point of view, because I was vaguely involved in the post-production, but nowhere near as much as the people around me. When I first got to see it on a big screen for the first time, what was really lovely for me, and it's worth mentioning right now, is the originator of the idea is my co-writer, a guy called Ryan McHenry, who did the original zombie musical shorts way back in 2010. That ultimately led to the feature we've developed today. And sadly, we lost Ryan to cancer in 2015. So to see what was the germ of his original idea and the script that we were co-writing together come through that long and really painful process. In fact, John came through obviously after the fact, but everyone else here was a friend of Ryan's, you know, it was really hard. But to be able to come through what we did and then to see a film that not only we were really proud of and that John had put such an amazing stamp on himself, but that other people are taking to heart now, is both amazing for us personally and also just a really beautiful thing, I think, in Ryan's memory.
And you mentioned Ryan there, and is there anyone in that you mentioned that you've all kind of been together for a while as a team and you've all kind of bonded. On a personal level, how did it feel then for you to now watch it back and then also feel that he's also put his touch on it even now? Do you kind of still feel that when you look at the film, or do you think he would be proud of what you've accomplished in terms of making a movie now that he wanted to make, but also you're going to make a movie that other people are going to watch at Christmas and have as part of their routine? How does that feel to you guys?
So I grew up with Ryan in Dumfries, and we made the short film Zombie Musical together. One of the things that he'd always wanted, and in fact, two of his favorite films, Die Hard and Gremlins, and actually has an incredibly similar taste to John, which is one of the reasons I think why it was such a good fit with what the script was at the time when John joined, and I think what initially, I think after the Fantastic Fest premiere, one of the reviews that came out said that this is going to be a Christmas classic. It'll happen, you know, I'll be watching Die Hard, Gremlins, and in the Apocalypse every Christmas from this year on. And I was like, okay, we probably did something right. And I think Ryan, right there, that would be something that we know means that Ryan would be proud of this film. It's obviously very difficult to work on a film with your friend for 5 years and then for him suddenly not being there. But when we all had a conversation and we're like, is this something that we should still do? It became much more important for us to do it, because it means that it is something that it is very much Ryan's, but it's also everyone here at this table, and it is very much John's film. And it's a really hard thing for someone, you know, someone like John to come in and have to fill the shoes of someone who's not there anymore. But actually, he didn't fill shoes. He just had his own shoes and brought them and made John's film. But I don't think that takes it away from being Ryan's vision and him. I can't speak for him, but I do think he'd be really proud of it.
And we're going to go now to another clip from the film.
I'm just going to turn you over.
Okay. Mate. Mate. Mate.
Call him mate again. It's definitely working. Stay here.
You stay here!
Sorry.
No signal.
Anna. That guy's a zombie.
There's no such thing.
Oh, right, because that's perfectly normal.
Now there's a great, without trying to give too much away, but there's a great part in the film where they're standing in the school and the first thing they do when they find out it's a zombie apocalypse is check their phones to see which celebrities are still alive. Where did you come up with this concept and this idea from? Because it's a really, really clever idea.
Don't know if I mentioned, but I was a teacher. first thing everyone does, actually this is a conversation Ryan and I used to have very often, which was about the fact that this is a really heightened story, and in many ways it kind of apes those American high school musical, or just high school stories generally. But if this really, the baseline, and John and I talked about this a lot as well, is if this actually happened to a bunch of teens, what would they actually do? They wouldn't, you know, it's not that they would all immediately become heroic and amazing. It's not that they would all immediately say, well, that's it, life is over, and we're just going to sit down. They would check their phones. They would see who else is a zombie. They would check the hashtags. They would check Instagram. They would, there's another little joke about hashtags in the movie as well. But no, fundamentally, it was just about treating people as real people. And I think that's what makes it funny, because when you think about it, it's, oh, they'll be awful if that happened. But also, we'd probably want to know if Justin Bieber was a zombie or not.
So we're going to throw the audience some quick chance to ask you questions. Before we do, if each of you were involved in a zombie apocalypse at Christmas, what would be your festive weapon you would use and why?
It's always going to be the same, but because it's Christmas, I'll just put lights around it, but a chainsaw, straight up.
Is that festive, yeah? at Christmas, I would hide. Yeah, I'd probably get the snow spade or snow plow. I'd get a snow plow. Yeah.
This is really, Christmas stuff's fundamentally nice. It's none of it's evil. I don't know what. I mean, holly's spiky, but I don't know.
It's just like pointing out, you're the man that wrote music for a zombie musical set at Christmas, and you're saying that Christmas stuff is insanely nice. It must be.
Yeah, but like as weapons, the Christmas stuff isn't weapons. I mean, presents. It's like you could throw a PlayStation at someone or something. I don't know. Like, I'd get a stick.
A Christmas stick.
Yeah, a Christmas stick. I'd get a really Christmassy stick or one of these.
There you go. I don't know. I'm not a big fighter. I wouldn't know what to do if I had a weapon, if I'm honest. So I might, like, if I could, look for a reindeer and ride it and escape.
I reckon I would get like Christmas wreaths and then just like add spikes around the edge and just have them as distance weapons, kind of throw for head chops, chopping off kind of thing.
It's not bad. What happens when you run out? Got it, right, okay. I've actually never thought about this, though. But I think I'd have a Christmas tree. Or like a good, like proper 6-foot Christmas tree. Because you can just put it in front of yourself. It's like a nice giant shield.
You can walk
around. Do a Macbeth.
Yeah, just tree.
You can go around.
Get out of the way.
The Christmas tree. You could just go around it.
It'd be great.
Yeah. Useless.
Great. Or you could use it as a giant spike.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right, well, we got some great T-shirts that we're going to give away, but in order to do that, you have to ask a question. So if you'd like to ask a question, then please feel free. So let's start off with someone down the front here.
Hi, guys. I love the film at Fright Fest this year. Blew me away. Just wondered, if you could do another genre mashup, what would you do and why?
So, we've talked about this, right? We'd, well, of course, people have always said to us, sequel, and you go, no sequel. But, like, we've loved working together, like, really, really loved working together. In that way, we're going, we would love to do something that's like Anna 2, but it's not Anna, you know, in that same way, it's the same cast and the same team behind it. And things like a sci-fi musical.
Sci-fi mockumentary musical.
Yeah. Set in space.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Think Spinal Tap.
Spinal Tap in space.
In space.
Yep.
So we've got a question here down the front.
Out of you, who's most likely to survive a zombie apocalypse?
I'm first gone.
Not Nic.
I'm first gone.
I think, well, not Nic.
Charlotte was gonna go, was gonna run away on a reindeer, so I think Charlotte probably would have survived.
No, I don't stand a chance.
We talked about this on the drive down, actually, right? Just to let you know. And what I said was, like, they were like, oh, get a camper van and drive away. And I'm like, the motorways are going to be all blocked up. What they do is you need to, like, chill out, take stock, wait a couple of weeks, then head out and head north, right? So these guys are dead because they're
definitely
stuck on the
dead.
M8 or the M1 or
definitely.
The M9.
Charlotte's on a reindeer. It doesn't matter about traffic.
I've died of panic. I'm dead.
It's right, we're very prepared for these. These are all our development questions that we asked each other before making the movie, so we're ready.
That's why movies are nice, because it's all imaginary. Please don't become zombies and chase us out.
And Christian here at the front as well.
Out of any horror film, how has influenced the film apart from Shaun of the Dead?
So there's loads and loads and loads of film references in this, because we are all just like film buffs, like big film fans. In fact, that clip you saw with the ball pit, the arm coming out, is like Evil Dead. There's two seashells that sit at the side of Anna's bed, which is like a reference to Demolition Man. There's like, we go into the graveyard and it's supposed to be like a nod to Night of the Living Dead. Like, there's so, like, as I say, we are all film buffs, like big film fans, and like strewn throughout the whole film there's like reference after reference, and people like are liking us to Shaun of the Dead because it's that British zom-com, which is nice because I love Edgar Wright and I think he's cracking. So yeah, there's been a few. I love John Carpenter, and there's a total, in fact, in one of the scenes, my editor used the theme from Escape from New York on it. It was like temp track stuff for the boys to be like, this is what we're looking at. So there's so much stuff throughout there.
And one of the things that the film, when it's being distributed in America, it's being distributed by Orion Pictures, isn't it? What is that like? Because they are a classic 80s distributor.
Yeah, I mean, it took a while to get that deal going, but Orion made, in the 80s and 90s, kind of made all of my favorite films. It's Terminator and it's Bill and Ted and Silence of the Lambs, and to have their logo at the start of our movie is, it's probably one of the coolest things that has ever happened to us.
Yeah, we were pretty much together the whole time for like 6 months in the same room, like talking about this, and the day that we were all together when we first laid the Orion logo on the start of the film and we all hit play, and it was pretty special. It was a special time.
I have a question here from your man.
Yeah, hello. I saw the film a few weeks ago and it's genuinely terrific. Really, really great. So two questions. Number one, John, by the way you're dressed, are you trying to get the Spider-Man gig? But secondly, were there any logistical problems to filming dismembered bodies on residential streets in Scotland?
So, like, my dream has always been to go to Comiccon or go along to these places, and the fact that I'm here with a movie and we were coming down and I was like, I made a Spider-Man costume for Halloween. There we go. I've even got my mask and everything. And logistic-wise, like, I was very lucky because I had my VFX supervisor on set with me. So, like, of course, we would prep for everything, and we would have talked about everything beforehand. But, of course, when you get on set, there's certain things that's not going to be right. So, like, Matt would always be there. Like, whenever, like, the, you know, just for, like, as I say, keeping the camera locked off, or we can be freehand, or, like, you know, things like that. So it was really good to have Matt there for, like, all that sort of stuff. Because he could tell you exactly how it was going to work, and he could see how it was going to be shot, that, you know, he would tell us to do this or not to do that, and we'd be able to then rely on that when we got any post. And he is a wizard, an absolute wizard.
It was mostly the difficulties that the production design department went through, the art department, after we'd been through the sets. I don't know if you remember that, John, what we got told and what you ignored.
So, we were filming in a school, and we were using this canteen, and the last day we were filming in the school, we had a big meeting before we went out onto location, my designer came into the meeting and he says, look, we cannot have what you've done to the canteen. we have to get industrial cleaners to come in to clean this canteen. There's a primary school about to move back into this school, and it's covered in blood. I'm talking about the from like top to bottom. It was like everywhere. And one of the things that he'd said to us to do was like, you know, we just can't have blood everywhere. It's just not going to happen. I was like, oh, don't worry, we're filming in this bowling alley. We're going to put tarp everywhere. You know, it's going to be fine. Don't you worry about it. And then we did, we had to crush a head with some bowling balls. And of course, what we didn't realize was blood goes up the way. So like in this bowling alley, like all the monitors and the ceiling was dripping with it. And I swear to you, the moment we'd finished shooting it, my designer walks in through the door and I was like, Ryan, hey buddy, come here. And he's like,
but
what is it?
The floor was clean.
And I took him along to see what we've done. And I was like, he's like, oh dude, what have you done? What have you done? I went, don't worry, it's gonna wipe off all those monitors. And he went, but what about the ceiling tiles? I was like, it's fine, we'll just turn them round. No one will know we've been here.
And we have a question here in the middle.
Hi, yeah, so I have to know, were there any funny moments that have happened on set that you just couldn't like stop laughing about? Like any pranks, practical jokes, anything like that?
I mean, one thing that jumps to mind is my little brother did the behind the scenes stuff on this film. He shot all the EPK stuff and the cast took a shine to him and made a making of the making of that we'll never see the light of day, but Connor was making the making of and they started filming him and it became this really intricate, complicated narrative involving the fact he liked to wear pillows on his head. It got very, very complicated. And like that just became this total object of like absolute joy every day, like contributing to that.
They shot location footage. Like they went away for a weekend and shot location footage of the making of the making of.
I think they covered VFX. More of Scotland making that than we did making the actual film.
There's a VFX shot on a horse. It's incredible. It's truly incredible. Incredible stuff.
And we've got time for one final question from this person here.
So the movie looks absolutely fantastic, but what I've got to ask you is there a particular scene that was like really fun to shoot or like overly amazing to do, that sort of thing?
I mean, there was loads and loads of real like fun moments, and one of the first ones we did was Hollywood Ending, and that was just like, I think because it was like on day 2 and 3 we shot that, and it was one of those moments where we kind of went, no, we've got something here. You know, this cat, like, you know, you're so many days in and you're like, for me, as a director, you don't spend that much time on set because, you know, most of the time is either in prep or in post. So you've only got like a small window and every minute counts. And we breezed through that and it was like, our background was amazing. My team were just so quick as well. Like the shooting of it was just so much fun. I think that's one of my favorites anyway.
Yeah, Hollywood Ending was amazing. There's one scene early on, which is relatively low-key. We always called it the Snow Angel scene, which is with the characters of Anna and John, and this is all to both the cast and to John's real credit here. We were running very, very long that day, and it's one of the most important scenes in the film. And production designer done an amazing job putting snow down and decorating the swing park for this gorgeous little scene between two friends that their entire story sort of hinges on. And I think John had an hour and a half to shoot that in. It was really tight. And he did an incredible job. And what was amazing for me was to see probably my favorite scene between two characters in the film, despite having been really stressed about how much time we had to do it, come out so beautifully. So that's my favorite scene. And the scene where I get to be a zombie.
Yeah, I was going to say the same thing. Like, Alan got to be a zombie. Nick got to be a zombie. But the highlight for me is I got to pretend I was in the high school band. Which was like a really, that was a pretty special day out. That was very fun.
I'm not sure I have a favorite scene. I've also seen this film about 700 times. So, you know, it's hard to differentiate them in my mind. But kind of like what John was saying about after Hollywood Ending, feeling like we've got something, The thing about post-production is I spend very little or no time on set at all, but I'm one of the first people who gets to see what we've actually shot. So, you know, hours after we've filmed, it comes into post-production and we watch it, and it's our chance to feed anything back to set if there are any continuity problems, et cetera, et cetera. Seeing Hollywood ending as well, I suppose, for me, coming in and just being like, wow, like, we're actually making this. And this is probably going to be okay, at least, was quite good. The bar was low at that time, so, you know, that was it for me.
Yeah, I think for me it was the filming the Sexy Santa song, because we just got 200 of our friends and family onto into a school hall and then shot it live. So Marley, who plays Lisa, was singing to them and performing this ludicrous song, and then there were guys coming in Sexy Santa short shorts and doing really inappropriate dancing. I had my cousins, little cousins, in the audience, and their mum like covers their eyes at one point, and that made it into the film because it was just such a great, genuine reaction. So it was great being able to show friends and family a bit of the madness that we were doing.
Nightmare. Alan stole my first favorite one, and Naysun stole my second favorite one. So third favorite.
The one you're in.
I mean, yes, the one I'm in was excellent. Which one? No, to be fair, when so there's a song later in the film by Paul Kay, who plays Savage, where he's kind of just singing and dancing around a kitchen that he just committed to so completely, and was just a case of like the cameras were following him around, and he was loving every second of it. It was a kind of wonderful thing to see, where you just walk in and go, This is some crazy nonsense we're making, but it's awesome.
And Nick is in it so much. So, like, don't worry about it the first time you watch it. Don't concentrate on it too much. But if you watch it a second time, see how many times you can see Nick. He's like, Nick is in it all the time.
So are you saying on the Blu-ray there's going to be like a counter?
Spot the Nick feature, maybe. Like, yeah.
Well, that is sadly all the time we have with you guys. But thank you very much, everybody here on the panel, for joining us. Let's give our panelists a massive round of applause. And you mentioned Hollywood ending. It is available to purchase now on iTunes and other online platforms, I believe.
Yeah, the whole album's available on Spotify, on iTunes, on Google, Amazon, wherever you get music. And they're
John,
on all of them.
John sings on one of them. The director's on there singing, so check it out.
There's also a novelization of the film that you can buy at all good book outlets.
And the movie's out on the 30th of November, so
yeah, please go.
Please
see
go
it.
Watch it.
Less than a week.
And let's see if we can make Hollywood ending Christmas number one. That would be pretty good.
No, Marvel.
The Sexy Santa one.
Sexy Santa one. You can't go for that, please.
I'd love that. Top of the Pops at Christmas, that single. Brilliant. Well, ladies and gentlemen, please give a massive round of applause to our panelists today from Annie and the Apocalypse.
Thank you very much.
And as I said, it is out on